Please welcome Jason Alexander!
Please, too much. You're embarrassing me. Please take your seats.
So many shows. Welcome, Jason.
Thank you.
So many shows from the 90s don't stand up. Seinfeld is timeless.
Is it now?
It is. Okay. No, it is. Now, obviously, they loved it in America, but does anyone outside of America love it as much as Australians?
No. Absolutely not. Seriously, half my fan mail comes from this country.
Really?
Yeah.
Really? Why?
We're still writing
because
mail?
You have nothing else to do. You're just fixated on a show from the 90s. Move on.
That's true. We love a good drink. We do. We do enjoy a drink time.
Right?
Which I imagine so many people offer you a drink after the show.
They do. And, you know, I don't really drink. And I've discovered something in Australia because... So people come and go, I love you, mate, love you. I'm going to buy you a pint, share a pint. And I go, I don't really drink. And they go, oh, all right, yeah. They think I'm being standoffish. So I've learned to say, I used to have a problem. And they go, ah, gotcha. Alcoholism, they understand.
It's not.
Yeah, exactly.
I like that you've got George Costanza's expertise at lying.
At lying, exactly. Had to come from somewhere.
So, obviously, incredible show. At what point... In the process of making this show over the 9 years, did you realise that you were working on the greatest sitcom of all time? Like, how long does it take for that penny to drop?
Well, that's very... I don't know that we ever quite realised that, or we would have put it that way. The success of the show happened very slowly. It actually was a bomb when it first started. We were barely able to stay on the air. We had a very small but very dedicated audience, and it grew very slowly. So I don't think we were ever, like, woke up one day and went, wow, bum. But it was, and of course, this is what the tour is named after, but it was after the contest episode aired, which was somewhere in our third season, we became overnight what's called a water cooler show, where everybody, during the course of airing that episode, was calling each other, going, do you see what they're doing? Do you see what... And everybody was talking about it at work the next day. And from then on, we had job security. I don't know that we thought we were the biggest show on TV.
Did you realize it was excellent, though?
Yes. I was proud of the show before it was successful.
Yeah. It's pretty social media, that contest. Like, you would have... Like, now you just follow the feed. Like, back then, how did you know you got away with that episode? So this is the episode where the four characters have a contest who could...
abstain. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. We knew we were in good shape when we got past the network came down. You have to read it for the network at the beginning of the week. We said, they're never going to let us do this. And that we read it, and they went, all right, go ahead. And we went, okay, we're home free. I think the most audacious thing in my memory was that Elaine was part of the contest.
Yeah. Yes.
The whole notion that a woman would be a part of something like that, and that she didn't win. And, you know, that was groundbreaking at the time.
Yeah.
So your character, George Costanza, was based on Larry David, who, of course, was the co-creator of the show.
Sure.
With Jerry. Did you know that?
No, and in fact, I don't know that Larry knew it either, to tell you the truth. So... The show was created from a bunch of Jerry Seinfeld stand-up sketches and observations and a bunch of Larry David observations and whatnot. When I first started doing the show, I thought I was doing Woody Allen. I had no other... That's where the glasses came from. That's where the really thick New York accent... When I started doing it, I was literally doing Woody Allen. I was, you know, stuttering and spitting and, you know. And about... A dozen or so episodes in, something came up on the show that I thought was preposterous, and I said to Larry, this would never happen, and if it did, nobody would react like this. And he went, this happened to me, and this is exactly what I did. And I went, oh! And at that moment, I realized that George might be a kind of an alter ego for Larry. And then I started really observing Larry and how his little tics and movements, and that's when I decided my role model would be him.
Because there were so many absurd moments. Like, we were looking today which couple of bits to play. We could work out which to pick. We picked this bit. This is one of our favourites.
All right.
Did that actually happen to Larry?
Oh, God, I hope not. No, but you know what's crazy about the clip? You know who the clown is?
Who?
That's Jon Favreau, who directed Iron Man and directed Lion King. And yeah, He was a great actor, director. He was the guy who'd never heard of Bozo the Clown. So, yeah. We launched a lot of careers on that show.
You're taking your live show around the country, and we've heard that... I can't believe it's 30 years that you're celebrating of Seinfeld, but that you're actually going to be playing live music. And I have a request. Please tell me that you are going to play this live.
Believe it or not, George, you're at home. Please leave a message at the beep. I must be out. Where could I be? Believe it or not, I'm not home.
It may not come up in the show, but I will tell you this. If I'm ever destitute, I've had more people offer me ungodly amounts of money to re-record that for their home answering machine.
Well, I mean, you're actually such a great singer. You're a regular on Broadway. You've won a Grammy.
I've not won a Grammy.
You haven't won a Grammy?
A Tony. I've won a Tony.
It was a Tony?
Yes.
Well, I mean, that's amazing.
It's good in its own right.
I'm still trying to get there.
Absolutely. I'll be an EGOT someday, but yes.
As someone that can sing, was it difficult for you to pretend you couldn't?
Extremely, because you can sing really terribly, you know, but to do it just bad enough that it's believable took some skills that... It took a while. Yeah. It really took a while to do that recording.
Yeah. We saw George push kids out of the way to get out of a burning building. Like, these characters weren't the most likable. We loved them because they were so funny. But this is like anti-heroes. Now, every drama has anti-heroes. But
sure.
Back then, comedy wasn't really doing these kind of anti-hero characters.
Nothing, no, it shouldn't have worked at all.
No.
No, I've traveled all over the world and people go, we love you, we love you. And I go, I remember the first time I went into the Palestinian territories. And I'm an American Jew, and I go, keep your head down. They don't know you, just walk. And a little street vendor went, George, George! And they all came running, and I went, what are they watching? How are they enjoying this? What are they seeing? You know, it amazes us. We don't know. Four of the most despicable human beings ever to grace a television.
Do you guys still catch up? Well, not you and Elaine, but you and Julia and Michael. Do any of you...
You know, so here's the interesting little story. We were never social friends. We were work friends. We had very different lives. Julia and I got pretty close because we were both the married ones. And when my wife and I were having our babies, she was having her babies. So we bonded all over that stuff. But we really... We hung out with each other at the show. We were workmates. And after 9 years, when the show ended, we kind of went, bye. See ya. So, you know, it's the birthday emails and it's but we don't really, you know, call each other up and go, hey, let's have dinner, you know. But when we do see each other, we fall. It's like no time has passed. Mm-hmm. It's right back into the
same what she's gone to create is phenomenal. I mean, Veep, other than Seinfeld, Veep's probably one of my favourites.
Oh,
so she's just exceptional.
She is.
Yeah.
It's just such a shame because I just had images of the four of you hanging out, just going to a cafe and people going past going, bloody hell, that's them!
We actually, one time, you know what, remember that famous Rolling Stone cover of the biker leathers that we were in? So we shot that in New York City and we filmed all of Seinfeld in Los Angeles. So it was rare we were all in New York together. So we said, okay, you know what? We're going to have dinner at an outside restaurant tonight. We're going to stop traffic dead. And we got out on that terrace, and nobody cared. Not one person. I think one woman stopped to ask directions, had no idea who we were.
You're a magician.
Sure.
Oh, of course you are.
Yeah.
Like, I was surprised to hear. Are people genuinely surprised when... Not because I doubt your talent, but just that... It's not
I'm an award-winning magician.
Yes, I heard.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, you want to see something real fast?
Yeah.
I'll show you my...
We've got 45 seconds. It's got to be
I can do it. My kid's favorite trick when they were little. Here's Cappy. Get a good shot. This is Cappy. He's on my finger. You're going to think that he's always on there, but he's not. He's always over here.
Right.
No matter what you think you see, he's not here. He's always going to be here. No matter where you think he is, he's always going to be over here. That's Cappy.
Wow.
Can we just stay and chat? Yeah. I know the show's finished, but we've got more questions.
All the information on Jason Alexander's tour is available on our website. Would you please thank magician and part-time actor Jason Alexander?